have no judges. That means more than one out of every four trial courts ay wala pong judge. Of course, we cannot deal with so many cases being filed until we can address that problem of a national vacancy rate. Another problem that we have is many of our trial judges are fond of making evidentiary rulings that do not specifically decide the evidence, for example, of the prosecution. So a judge will say, oh, your evidence is admitted for whatever it's worth. And now you have the defense counsel saying, I don't know what evidence has been admitted by the prosecution, so I will now adopt a shotgun approach. I will present as much evidence as I can because I want to ensure that my client is acquitted. And that really causes a cluttering of the record and also, as well, a lot of delay. A third problem I think we have in our court procedure is the lack of a mechanism for pre-trial motions to suppress. If only we could adopt that mechanism, which has been followed in the States and in many other countries, many cases that reach the Supreme Court after 15 years and are thrown out by the Supreme Court, for example, for lack of counsel in a confession, eh, yun po sana, sa pre-trial pa lang natapos na yung issue na yan. And we would save a lot of money and a lot of time if we could adopt that kind of procedure.
Thank you, Dean. If I may just say something with respect to your observation that there are 26.9% of our courts that are unfilled, it may interest you to know that we are now trying to trim down that percentage by ensuring that all courts, regardless of caseload, will be filled as soon as possible, and that although we are experiencing difficulty in filling up courts in the remote areas, include especially in Tawi-Tawi, there are no applicants. So perhaps you might want to encourage your friends to join the judiciary and, you know, volunteer for the far-flung areas.
One of the other things, Your Honor, that I would like to see happen is that even in law school, our students will already be given the track, they offered the opportunity to enter the judiciary. Perhaps in the future we could have a system where when you enter law school, you will already elect that if you want to become a judge, you can take certain special courses that will qualify you for the prejudicature requirements, so that later, at least from the time they are in law school, we can already form their mind into believing that they will be judges of the country.
Unfortunately, also, we don't have a system of internship in the courts.
That would be nice, too.
What safeguards would you give, assuming that we would allow clerkship in the courts to ensure that the issues of confidentiality does not become a problem?
I think the clerkship is a very good idea. It's been done very successfully in other countries, Australia, I believe, in the States and other developed countries. We could probably copy from them, get the same kinds of safeguards that they use initially, and then develop our own from there.
Thank you, Dean. My last question. You have a lot of good proposals. You have a vision as to what you would want our courts to deliver to the underprivileged. But how will you get, if you are appointed Chief Justice, how will you get the present members of the Supreme Court who are more senior in age and who have more judicial experience to support your proposals?
I don't think any amount of talking to them or convincing them will do. It will only have to be by example. That's the only way that I know how to lead.
And by that you mean?
I mean that I will not ask anything of the other members of the court that I will not willingly do myself.
Thank you. That was my last question. Good luck, Dean.
Thank you.
Thank you, Justice.
Attorney Mejia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. good afternoon, Dean Jokno.
Good afternoon, sir.
As Attorney Cayos pointed out earlier, this is not the first time that you're going through this process, as in fact, we interviewed you more than a year ago.
Yes.
If you will be appointed as Chief Justice, you know that you will be the ex officio chair of the Judicial and Bar Council.
Yes, sir.
And having seen the process of vetting candidates like you to the position, what reforms, if any, would you introduce in the process of vetting candidates for the position?
I'm very happy to hear that question because I do have a lot of concerns about the process of appointment of judges. And I don't mean to refer to the Judicial and Bar Council itself, but rather to the system of appointment. I understand that in other countries, they have made it less politicized by giving some of the power to the citizenry. Not all members of the judicial and bar councils in some other countries are appointed by the president or members or considered public officers. Perhaps that would be one way of democratizing the process. I see, for example, in front of me, I believe all the members of the council are members of the bar. But being appointed a judge is something that all Filipinos citizens have a concern with, and I think that other sectors in society also have an equal interest in terms of deciding who should get into the short list. So I would like to see a greater participation, not only from within the bar itself, but from the other sectors of society.
Coming from the academe, Dean, how do you intend to continue regulating the law schools? Will you also introduce any reform in the manner by which law schools are regulated?
Well, that, as I understand it, is now primarily the function of the Legal Education Board. But insofar as my position, if ever I'm appointed as Chief Justice, I would like to see, for one thing, legal aid made a requirement, perhaps, or at least highly encouraged among law students. Some medical profession, po, when you become a doctor, you have, I think, as up to now, you're still required to render community service. Perhaps something like that will help, because a lot of the problems, especially of the poor, could readily be resolved even by a new lawyer. All they need is access to counsel. Unfortunately, in our country, it's very hard for many of our brothers and sisters to get that access.
Talking about free legal aid, and given your background as a flag lawyer, do you think poor and indigent litigants are properly represented in our courts of law today?
There's a lot to be desired as far as that goes. I really feel for the PAW lawyers, because when I go to court and I see them, talagang punong-puno po sila ng kaso. Many of them have a difficult time, not because they're incompetent, but no, it's because they just have too much work and they can't do it. We don't have, unfortunately, a system here, a local system of appointment of the official counsel that is as active as in other jurisdictions that I've seen. In many other places, they have a role of attorneys in every local court, where when they need the official counsel, kung walang power, if it's an important case, they can appoint from that. And I think those kinds of systems should be revived.
What, to your mind, are the key hindrances to the efficient and speedy disposition of cases, Dean Jo?
You're referring, sir, to the criminal cases, pre-sentence disposition?
All cases, for that matter.
Well, for one thing, I think that we have been applying rules of court and rules of evidence that were designed for a different system. We apply our rules of evidence, we lifted that from the Code of California. Our rules of court are mainly copied from the federal rules of civil and criminal procedure. I have no problem with getting rules from other countries, but the problem is, ang America po is a jury system where they have to have very strict rules, because the judge and the jury are separate persons. The judge is the one who screens the evidence so that the jury will not hear it. But in our jurisdiction, the judge and the jury is just one person. The judge actually hears inadmissible evidence. It is now up to him, because of his training, to be able to screen that out in order not to make it influence his decision. So I don't think many of the rules that we have, really, which were designed for a jury, can be streamlined so that we can apply it to a bench jury system that we have here.
For my final question, in your opinion, did the impeachment of the former Chief Justice infringe on judicial independence? Why or why not?
No, I don't think so. And I think that the impeachment of the Chief Justice gave the people a number of lessons. The first lesson, I think, is that the people are also looking for transparency, not only in the executive and the legislature, but also as well in the judicial branch. And one of the issues, of course, there has to do with the statement of assets and liabilities of the Chief Justice. I would like to see a more transparent judiciary, both in respect to the SALN rules as well as in respect to its use of funds.
As I said, that's my final question. Good luck, Dean Jokney. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Justice Lagman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Dean Jokno, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Pa.
You stated a while ago in answer to the question of Attorney Mejia about the effect of the impeachment of the former Chief Justice. Now, considering the negative effect of that impeachment, in your opinion, what kind of a Chief Justice do we need today?
To me, thank you both for that question. To me, the biggest problem facing the judiciary is the people's loss of faith in the system. I would not even use the word public confidence, because for me, it's even deeper than that. Karamihan po ng mga kapatid natin, hindi na po naniniwala sa husgado. And it's really unfortunate, but that will have to be the very first priority of the next Chief Justice. Mm-hmm. How could he address that? Well, if ever I am appointed, I would address it with a 4-point program. First, I would call for more judicial transparency. Mm-hmm. Second, I would call for more public accountability. Mm-hmm. Third, I would call for no more flip-flopping of decisions that are final in nature. Mm-hmm. And fourth, I would call for faster and cheaper justice. If I may explain each of these 4 points, Your Honors.
Yes.
First, I think, as I said earlier, the people to restore the people's faith in the judiciary, we must show them that the judiciary is transparent. And transparency can only be reflected in two ways, in terms of access of the public to the statement of assets and liabilities, and in terms of the use of public funds.
Yes.
And I think the Chief Justice will have to take the role, the lead, as far as those two matters are concerned. As far as public accountability is concerned, I have this very, very serious issue. Up to now, Your Honors, please, our courts have no central monitoring system to determine if a person convicted by final judgment, meaning already affirmed by the Supreme Court, is actually serving time in jail. We have no central record system to determine where, in fact, those people are. Now, how can we have a state of accountability if we cannot even tell how many of those convicted by final judgment are inside Muntinlupa?
Okay.
So to me, it's really very important that not only the courts, but the Department of Justice and the Ombudsman realign their priority, not simply for conviction rates, but to determine whether those convicted are actually serving their sentences. I understand that there was a study made around 2007 or 2006, and it was submitted to the Ombudsman, where the study reported that out of 100 or so had been convicted of corruption-related offenses, only about 10 were actually in jail. Now, I do not know if that study is accurate, but if it is, it is a very disturbing statistic.
Mm-hmm.
Second, I would call for the perpetuation, I would call for the review of the rules of court to allow for the perpetuation of whistleblowers' testimonies and other witnesses who are vulnerable. Mm-hmm. Ang karamihan po ng mga kaso natin, especially the big cases of corruption, of course the witnesses there will always be in danger.
Yes.
What happens is when they're in danger, they will spend maybe 5 years, 10 years in a safe house waiting for their case to get to trial. In the meantime, yung mga akusado are out roaming around.
Yeah.
So of course, naturally, they lose their interest and many of those cases never get pursued. An amendment of the rules of court to allow for perpetuation of prosecution witnesses, whistleblowers, and others in danger, I think would be a very good development as far as the issue of accountability is concerned.
Mm-hmm.
As far as flip-flopping, well, I'm sure everyone in this room is aware of the dangers and why we should not stop, why we should not have this practice. Legally, it is a violation of the doctrine of immutability of judgments. And that doctrine is the bedrock of any legal system. Because the moment that any judgment that's final can be reopened, then really people will lose faith. Hindi na po talaga maniniwala ang tao sa sistema. As far as the faster and cheaper justice is concerned, I would have several proposals to address that. First, of course, as I mentioned earlier, we should fill the vacancies in the trial courts. Second, we should require lower court judges to make specific evidentiary rulings. Third, I would revisit the rules on court fees and pauper litigants. I know that under the Algura case, the Supreme Court now says you don't have to strictly apply Rule 141, you can apply Section 3 of Rule 3,
yeah,
which is a more liberal standard.
Mm-hmm.
But still, some of our trial courts are still applying Rule 141, and I would want them to be aware that there is a better standard perhaps that should be applied. And finally, well, I would also push for the increase of the appropriations for the judiciary, because it's not only judges, but it's all the court personnel who need a lot of assistance, perhaps, so that we will be able to have that kind of independence that is needed for a judiciary.
Okay. That is a very interesting points which you have raised.
Thank you.
Now, insiders in the judiciary are saying that the appointment of an outsider as Chief Justice will cause demoralization within the ranks of the career judges and justices. Do you want to comment on that?
From a purely objective point of view, I would say that is really something that's within the prerogative of the president, given our constitutional framework. And it is something that I think we should not tie the hands of the president as far as that decision is concerned. After all, he is the one we have elected to run this country, and we should also respect his judgment.
So if that happens and you will be appointed as the next Chief Justice, how are you going to address that problem of demoralization within the ranks of the career justices and judges?
I'm not so sure, but that that would be the necessary result, that there would be demoralization. There have been previous instances, I believe, in our judicial history where justices have been appointed from the outside. Mm-hmm. And although there is, I'm sure in the beginning, there will be a lot of adjustments
resistance.
Over time, I am confident that that can be overcome.
I see. Okay. During the impeachment trial of the former Chief Justice, the issue on the moral fitness of the Chief Justice came out. Can you tell us your perception of moral fitness as a criteria in selecting a Chief Justice?
I think, Your Honor, a Chief Justice must be something like a monk in terms of his life. If you would look at the rules of judicial ethics, there are so many social activities that are not exactly encouraged from members of the bench. Mm-hmm. And these are the kinds of activities that would put judges or justices in contact with potential litigants and actual litigants.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, I'm happy to say that I do not have that kind of a lifestyle. Hindi naman po ako mahilig sa mga ganyan. Mm-hmm. Actually, I would rather stay at home, read a book, watch TV, and do my study, my law, rather than go out. I don't even play golf. So as far as that's concerned, I don't think there's any problems.
So if you will be appointed as the next Chief Justice, how do you want to be remembered?
I'd like to be remembered as someone who was able to improve the system for the majority of the public, for the majority of the people, someone who can say that we can truly, genuinely deliver justice to the people. Right now, po, law and justice are two separate concepts for the poor. For many of our poor, they identify the law with naked power. And they see justice as just a dream, something that they can never attain in their lifetime. And I would like, at the end, if ever I can leave a legacy, to say that I have brought justice back into law.
Okay. On that point, Mr. Chair, I have no more question for Dean Jokno. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Justice Hermosissima. Good afternoon, Dean.
Good afternoon, Justice.
I can see that you are as eloquent as your father.
Thank you, Pa.
You see, the tremendous inherent power in the hands of the Chief Justice and the Associate Justice of the Supreme Court require that those appointed to the position should possess the highest degree of competence, integrity, and judicial prudence. Because the administration of justice is a sacred task, entrusted only to individuals with the highest degree of competence. A judicial post is a position of honor, and is offered only to those who are best qualified. Considering this, if you are appointed Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the Philippines, what would be your judicial philosophy?
I like to think of myself, Your Honor, as a liberal, but I would qualify that a liberal who is imbued with a philosophy that respects human rights. For me, that would have to be the bedrock of everything I do as a lawyer and even as a person. So in terms of philosophy, of course, there are what they call the loose constructionists and the strict constructionists. You have those who believe in the Constitution as a living document rather than the opposite. In all of those, and those who would call themselves a judicial activist rather than a judicial someone who's very conservative, I would say I'm more on the judicial activist side, although not on that extreme. I would probably be more inclined towards a loose interpretation of the Constitution, and I would look at the Constitution as a living document.
The problem is there is no strict interpretation of what human rights are.
Yes, Your Honor, but the basis of all human rights is universal, and these are principles that apply to any person in any country, regardless of his birth, origin, background, family, relations, or anything like that. And I would like to think that even in our country, because we have incorporated international law as part of the law of the land, that all our courts are obligated to respect, protect, and promote human rights.
Do you not adhere to the resolution of the United Nations as to human rights?
The Universal Declaration, of course, Your Honor, as well as the International Covenant, civil and political rights, economic, social, and cultural rights. Yes, sir.
Does this mean to say that you are more inclined to favor the accused rather than the offended parties?
No, Your Honor, because you will find victims of oppression and human rights both on the side of the accused and on the side of the prosecution. The prosecution as well promotes the human rights by prosecuting those who violate the human rights of others. So I think, Your Honor, it would cut both ways.
Do you agree with the motto of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines, which says, no master but law, no guide but conscience, no aim but justice?
Yes, I think that's a good motto, although I have my own personal motto, which I inherited from my father. This comes from Carl Llewellyn, where he said that technique without ideals is a menace. Ideals without technique are a mess. One must apply both technique and ideals with vision. And to me, that would be the my mission as a lawyer and as a jurist.
Well, there is no mention of justice in that motto. What then is your concept of justice, Dean?
Well, my concept of justice...
Of course, I'm warning you that was it Disraeli who said that if you define justice, you limit it. And
yes, Your Honor.
If you limit it, you destroy it. Anyway, Chief Justice Laurel has already defined what is social justice. What is your concept of justice?
My concept of justice is something concrete, something that the people can see happening in reality, not just a lofty ideal, not just something we strive for endlessly without ever experiencing it, but something that they can feel in their hands, that they have been aggrieved, therefore they have managed to get justice from the courts. To me, that would be the greatest legacy that anyone, I in particular, could leave with the court.
As a magistrate, Jean, you decide cases on the basis of law.
Yes, Your Honor.
Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Based on the facts, considering the facts in a certain case and the law involved. Now, considering the motto of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines, if the law is not in accordance with your conscience, will you abide by the law?
As a judge, I would have no choice but to abide by the law. But of course, how I would interpret the law would have to depend on what is available to me in that particular case. If I feel that, as provided in our rules and in our law, when a judge feels that the law he is applying is unjust, is unfair, then he can do everything he can to appeal to the proper body to repeal that law.
If the law is not in accordance with your concept of justice, will you abide by the law?
It's very difficult to answer that point in the abstract. In fact, it's hard for me to conceive of a situation like that, except perhaps if it comes from if it's a corrupt order. Then if it's a corrupt order, then I think that that's not an order that ought to be abided by, Your Honor.
When you enter the portals of the Supreme Court of the United States, you can see emblazoned there the words equality under law. Perhaps a revelation of the court's judicial philosophy. Here, in the Supreme Court of the Philippines, what do you have? Batas Bayan. No, so in short, what can be your judicial philosophy?
Well, my judicial philosophy.
If you have these phrases as a paragon.
My judicial philosophy, Your Honor, as I said earlier, would be to concentrate on delivery of justice, especially to the masses who comprise our population, finding all the different ways and means that we can make justice real to them rather than just a dream, finding ways to give them more access to lawyers, finding ways to give them more access to the courts, because the sad truth is that many of our courts, it's just too expensive for many of our people to litigate cases. Even cases that are very strong, cases that are meritorious, but lack the proper resources on the part of the litigants, very often they don't end up prospering because of the situation.
Dean, you've never been a magistrate before.
No, Your Honor.
Not a judge, not a justice. Will you not find it difficult to go directly to the position of Chief Justice without passing through the Associate Justice or even RTC judges, MTC judges?
It will definitely be a challenge, but I would like to say that I have been going to court for more than 20 years, and from what I've seen, there have been some excellent justices who came straight from private practice. The beauty of it, Your Honor, is that I have seen how justice works firsthand at close range. I've seen it in the lowest of the lowest courts up to the highest of the highest courts. So I would like to bring that experience to the court if I can.
Well, that experience as an advocate, John.
Yes, Your Honor.
You can see that there's a whale of difference between your experience as an advocate and your experience as a magistrate.
Yes, there is a very big difference, and I would have to make sure that I will rid myself of the advocate's attitude if ever I am appointed to the court.
On that note, thank you very much.
Thank you, Justice.
Secretary Mosny.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to say first that I'm happy to know that the LaSalle program rests in your very good, that capable hands.
Thank you.
Dean Jokno, do you consider yourself a religious person?
Perhaps spiritual might be closer to it, although I would not.